Good morning. Good welcome. I'd like to welcome you into the church this morning. Thank you so much for being here on this just right before Christmas time right here. Thank God for Christmas time. We appreciate each and every one of you. As you can see, we're getting ready for the play this evening. So we won't have the choir, but we will have the entire church choir this morning. So if you will, let's all stand. Turn over to page number 569. 569. O come all ye faithful. Page number 346, 346, beautiful Star of Bethlehem.
Thank you.
got a few specials this morning. Brother Jonathan, Miss Hannah, y'all come on. Miss Maddie, wherever you may be. Miss Maddie, there she is. I'm gonna let you sing first, sis, if you don't mind.
The stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, oh, hear the angel voices, for night divine, oh, night when Christ was born. Truly he taught us to love one another. His law is love and his gospel is peace. Chains shall he break, for the slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy in faithful chorus raise we. Let all within us praise his holy name. Christ is the Lord. Oh,
that your baby boy would one day walk on water. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy would one day make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm a storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you've kissed your little baby, you have kissed the face of God. Mary, did you know? The blind will see. Your baby boy is Lord of all creation. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb. And that sleeping child you're holding is the great I Am. Oh, Mary, did you know?
Good morning. Got a couple announcements. As already been mentioned, the Christmas play tonight at 6 o'clock, and we do have two or three of the cast that's out with the flu, so we'll have to switch stuff around. So if you see somebody reading the play part tonight, just think nothing about it. So y'all just remember that and just come support them and keep them in your prayers. And the Christmas card exchange, all the Christmas card boxes in the nursery, if it's full, you know, there's several of them that's full. It's got a bunch of them that tried to pass some out this morning. So just remember to get your cards. And Misty and I will keep those up till the first of the year. So keep that in your prayers. Any other announcements? Any birthdays this week? I know Ty had one Friday. He didn't stand up last week. Somebody got pointed out. Leah. Maddie. We got several of them. Hey, happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Any unspoken prayer requests, raise the hand. We stand, we get some ushers, please. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for today, Father, and all you've done for us, Father. Just thank you for giving us a place to come worship you, Father. Father, for this Christmas play tonight, Father. Just touch each one who's participating in it, Father, and just touch each audience member who comes and supports them, Father. Father, and just use us for you, Father, in our everyday walk, our everyday talk, Father, that people will see you through us. And Father, Brother Austin comes, Father, just take him, hide him behind the cross, Father. Give him the words to say, Father, Lord. Father, just touch him physically, Father, spiritually, Father. Father, for the remainder of this service, if there's that one here that's backslidden, Father. Father, if there's that one here that's a heavy burden, Father, just let them come leave everything with you this day. If there's that one here that's lost, Father, Father, just show them, Father, just prick their heart, knock on their heart's door, Father, and draw them to you, Father. They'll accept you as Lord and Savior, Father, and just use us for you in our everyday walk, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Thank you for being here this morning. If you're not too afraid to, why don't you stand and just welcome the folks around you to church this morning? Do that if you will.
You better.
Bless you, brother.
Glad you're back today, brother.
Bless you, man.
Everybody.
Love you, buddy.
Appreciate you.
Amen. As we said before, we're certainly thankful that you're here today. A lot of our folks are missing. We ask that you pray for them, especially our cast members. I know it's going to be very disappointing to some of them if they're not able to be here. As much practice and effort as they put into trying to be a blessing with the Christmas program, and we certainly pray for them. And as you can look around the building, and you see a good many folks are missing. But I tell you something else you see. You see the building more full than empty. Amen. And that's something to be thankful for. And certainly we pray for all of the folks we know that's dealing with the flu and other things. I've even heard of some surgeries this morning I didn't know about. I apologize for that, but I didn't know about that. But we pray that those are going well. And today, I want to just share a short message with you this morning. Certainly have enjoyed all the good singing today. I tell you, Jonathan, you have proved that you are not afraid when it comes to a song, buddy. I'll tell you that. And a lot of people won't tackle that song, will they? Even Michael Phelps' face turns as red as Joe Biden in church when he sings that. So I just enjoyed all the singing, not to put that song above any of the others that was sung. I've often thought how amazing it was that Mark Lowry wrote Mary, Did You Know? He's a nut. And to write a song so serious and so in-depth, you know, so scriptural. But yeah, we just appreciate all our singing today. And so this morning, I want to talk about showing the real you, the real me. This applies to all of us. I'm going to read you several passages of Scripture today, and we'll look at this particular thought. The Lord had placed this in our thoughts about Tuesday of this past week, and certainly I've had a lot of opportunities to show the real me. I've had a good little bit of adversity this week, things that came up unexpectedly, that kind of thing. I do like to put folks down a little bit. Well, I better not say put them down. I do like to pick at them and aggravate them a little bit driving these Chevrolets, but if it wasn't for a Chevrolet, I couldn't have got my Ford home Friday night. What about that? And so I have to walk that back a little bit. But looking at Matthew's gospel, the Christmas story, that'd be Matthew chapter 1. But we're not going to stay there. Actually, you could go to Luke chapter 1. It'd be probably where we'll land and spend the most time. But in Matthew chapter 1, verse 18, very familiar to most everyone, it said, "Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. When as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privately." Let me read that verse again to you. I want you to really get that one down in your thinking. It has a real bearing on what we need to talk to you about this morning. "Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privately. But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost." I'm going to go now to Luke's gospel, chapter number 1, and verse number 27. Let's look at that verse for a moment. It said, let me just read verse 26 to set that up. "And in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth." That 6 month means Elizabeth now has been expecting for 6 months. "It said, to a virgin, a spouse, to a man whose name was Joseph." I want you to notice, Joseph's name was mentioned before Mary's. "Of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women." I'm going to skip over now to verse 30. "And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary," first time that Gabriel has used her name, "for thou hast found favor with God." Second time that Mary has been told. She has gotten favor with God. Now I'm going to go on down to verse 38. And Mary said, "Behold the handmaid or the slave girl of the Lord. Be it unto me according to thy word." And the angel departed from her. Let's pray together this morning. Father, we're thankful to be back in the house of God today. Thankful, Father, for the wonderful songs that we have been able to enjoy, the ones that we sung together, and certainly the ones, Father, that we listened to Miss Maddie and Jonathan and Hannah sing. Father, we're certainly thankful for everybody that's in this building this morning. Lord, you've blessed us once again. Father, we have not come to an empty sanctuary, but even though there's people we appreciate and love are not able to be here today, Lord, there's still people that had a desire to be in the house of God today. Not that those did not, Lord, but they have come. And Father, they have all throughout these pews, Lord, there's people sitting on every pew. And so, Father, we don't take that a bit for granted. We appreciate that so much. And we pray for those people, Father, dealing with flus, dealing, Father, with aftermaths of surgeries, dealing with a number of different sicknesses and issues. Father, some of them, Lord, have been brought on by the conditions of the weather, and Father, by the conditions that we're dealing with right now, with a lot of people that are sick and that going around among people. But Father, we pray for their recovery, Lord. I know some of them are getting better, just not quite good enough to be here today. But Father, we thank you, Lord, that they are coming through this time and they're coming through this season. And we pray for those, Father, too many to mention by name this morning, Lord, that we've been asked to pray for different things. Father, we just pray for them, Lord, listening for and expecting, Lord, something better and better, Father, and something, Father, that's, excuse me, Lord, that is, that's wellness for them. Lord, we pray for the play tonight. Lord, that you will bless the cast members. Lord, I know that they'll deal with things fine. Father, there's no doubt about it. They have a heart to present this. Lord, it won't be just a play or a drama that we can watch, but they've got a ministry mindset about it. And so they're determined, Lord, to be a blessing and for it to go forward. And so we ask you, Father, that you will bless in that, Lord, and the message of the play will be received. And Father, you'll be honored with it. And Lord, so we ask you now that you'll preach your message through us today. Lord, give us caring, compassionate kindness, but also give us great courage, Lord, and a loving boldness in the Holy Spirit. Because, Father, people are looking to see somebody genuine today. Lord, we'll have plenty of opportunities through this Christmas season, especially as we meet and as we interact with our families. There'll be plenty of opportunities for people to see just who we really are. And so, Father, we'll thank you and praise you for these things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'd like to share a little story with you this morning to get us started, talking about showing the real you today. I've got a friend, and I won't mention his name because many of you would know him. He's been a right prominent fella in the family, in the county, I meant to say. Served in government, served in the military, and many of y'all would know him. And nice fella, good fella. But when he was in junior high school, the teacher that they had for this particular subject, she wore pretty thick glasses, but she could hear a pin drop in the back of the room. And she had this homework paper that she had assigned, and it was going to be a pretty important, significant grade for their final. And so there was one fella that was a friend of my friend, and he was kind of, you know, felt like he was a little bit favored in the class, a little bit of a teacher's pet. Or it wasn't on his behalf, but it was on hers. She kind of liked him pretty good. And so this particular homework paper, he forgot at home. He had it laid out. He was going to bring it, but he forgot it at home. Well, my friend that I'm talking about, he turned his paper in. And so she graded it, and she graded it with a pencil and put a B on there. And she gave it back to him, and his buddy, the one that she liked a little bit, his buddy told him, said, man, let me have yours. I said, let me just turn that in, see if that'll work. And he said, well, I don't, he said, yeah, let me just have yours. So he erased his B off there, and he went and turned it in. She graded that same paper and gave him an A. What about that? That really showed a little bit how she really was, didn't it? And my friend, till this day, still fusses about that. He still complains about that, how the same paper got a B for him and an A for his buddy. And so you might say, well, you know, we're seeing the real you this morning. I wish that'd be true. But you're not actually seeing the real me this morning. I'm not trying to be deceptive, hypocritical, anything like that, but I have planned this morning. As a matter of fact, I've thought about this. I've rehearsed this in my mind, and I've studied about this. And so, no, I've got this planned. I've got a strategy this morning. And so you're not actually seeing the real me. It's been said, to really know somebody, you either got to live around them or you got to work with them. You got to be somewhere in close proximity with them to really get to see the real way that person is. Because when you present a design plan, that kind of thing, that's not exactly, there's elements of that person there, but that's not exactly the way they are. As a matter of fact, if you want to see how a person really is, you want to really get the determination and what's in their heart, it's how they react. It's not how they plan to act, but it's how they react to things that come up in their life, to things that they face. As I read to you this morning, you're going to notice something about Joseph. Can you imagine? Mary was told twice here that she was favored. As a matter of fact, the scripture said highly favored. Some would say this morning that what the Lord was asking Mary to do certainly was not doing Mary any favors. I mean, because Mary, she was obviously a young woman of good reputation. We know that these people would be considered peasants in their day. We know that because of the offering that was made for Christ when he was brought to the temple to be circumcised, and an offering was to be made for him. They made an offering of pigeons and turtle doves. That was the poorest offering that could be offered and still be accepted. And so the highest offering would be a lamb without spot or blemish. Next to that would be a bull calf without spot or blemish. But then after that, you get on down all the way down to the bottom, and you've got the pigeons and the turtle doves. And so that's what Mary and Joseph offered. So we know by that, we can see by that their social standing or status, where they fit in that society in that day. But Mary had a good reputation. And so for Mary to be seen as pregnant before she's actually married, that's going to tarnish her reputation. For this child to be born and to be seen as a person who was born before the actual marriage ceremony had taken place, then that was going to be frowned on and looked down on. And we know that that was thought about. We know that that was in the mindset of the Pharisees, because when you read John chapter number 8, the Pharisees told Jesus, when they told Christ that they were Abraham's children, Christ told them if they were Abraham's children, then they would love him. And he said, they said, we be not born of fornication. In other words, that was a direct criticism. That was a direct smear and slam on Christ himself. That's what they were talking about. In other words, your mom is expecting you before Joseph and Mary actually was formally married. The Bible tells us this. And so many would say, and then considering what Mary would have to go through with Christ being her son, watching him do all the things that he did, and then going through that mock trial, going through the rejection, going through the persecution, going through these Pharisees and Jews, Sadducees, these people just hounding him, trying to get something on him, trying to figure out something against him. All the time, you remember what Simeon said, that he was set for the rise and the fall in Israel. And so Simeon tells Mary right there in the temple that day of the sacrifice how her heart would be broken because of the things that the Lord would go through. And so Mary was called to that. And so given all that was going to, the responsibility and all it was going to entail for Mary to be the mother of the Christ child, some would say that's not really favoring her too much. Well, Mary saw it as a blessing. Why? Because, listen, she was reacting trusting to what God had motivated and put into her life to do. And so the way she reacted was the right way, wasn't it? The way that she accepted it, the way she embraced it, what she looked at is she saw this as God's doing. And if it's God's doing, then God can get it done. If it's God's will, it's God's bill. If it's God's instruction, then God will finish it. He will bring it to an end. Mary saw it like that. Why? Because her heart was sanctified before the Lord, and it was set upon the Lord. I could ask you today, this morning, what are we doing in the kingdom of God? What are we doing in the calling of God? What are we doing for the cause of Christ? And you might say, well, he hasn't really placed any burden on my heart to do. He hasn't motivated me to do anything. He hasn't placed a door to be open for me to do anything. He hasn't given me anything to do. Can I say to you, friend, you are absolutely, positively, completely lost, and I want to give you an opportunity to be saved today, because there's nobody in the kingdom of God that is saved by the amazing grace, listen, and the blood of Jesus that don't have something to do in the kingdom. Do you hear me? It don't work like that. Not like that. You might say, oh, you're way out on a limb here, preacher. You shouldn't say that. Well, listen, I can back it up by this. It's not my opinion. No. It's what this word says, friend. I'm telling you, listen, hey, our children have certain responsibilities in the family, don't they? Why? Because they're in the family. Friend, I have certain responsibilities in mine. Why? Because I'm in mine. I don't expect you to help take care of my mom when she needs it. You might do it, and I'd appreciate it. But friend, I do it. Why? Because it's my mom. I don't expect you to take care of Cindy when she needs it. You might help do it. I appreciate it. But I do it because she's my wife. Tracy, the same way, all these kind of things. Friend, can I say to you today, hey, there's nobody. God loves us enough. He's invested too much in us. He's done too much for us that you and I are just going to be bench warmers today. No. If you're a saved person, there's something in your life. There is a motivation in your heart. He's given you something to do. Yes, he has. Given you something to do. I've had the opportunity to work a number of people down through my life and the things that I've worked in to make money. And I'll tell you, the ones that I appreciate the most is the ones that hunt something to do. Amen? Yes, they do. They run out of something to do. They'll look for something to do. Why? Because they understand they're there, listen, to be profitable. Hey, you and I need to understand that today. We're a part of the kingdom of God. Listen, not just so we can get out of hell, not just so we'll miss that terrible punishment. Thank God for that, but we're part of the kingdom because he's got a part for us, amen. He's got something to do. I don't know about you. I don't want to be a part of something that's not active, not living, not current, and things are not flowing and going. I don't want to be a part of something dead. What about you? Anybody ever see a dead possum on the road? You just pull up and stop and look at him for a little while? Watch him swell up. I mean, even dead things swell up, amen? Even dead things get bigger. Do you know that? I come by a deer one time, and about 2 days later, I came by him. Lord have mercy, he looked like he gained 87 pounds. Why? I'm telling you, friend, he's dead. But listen, I don't want to be a part of something dead. Did you notice that Joseph, that I read to you, the scripture I read to you first, did you notice that Joseph, before God explained to him, before the Holy Spirit confirmed Mary's confession and her story, Joseph was doing the right thing. Did you notice how he responded? The verse that I read to you twice, what did he do? The Bible said that he took her aside, that he put her away, that he didn't want to make her a public example. Listen, can you imagine what was going through his mind? It was like a stab at his very heart. He thought this woman was the right one. He thought this woman would be a compliment, would be a blessing, would be a help, would respect him, would honor him, would love him. He thought that their family would be built with this woman. I mean, hey, it was like Proverbs chapter number 31. Listen, he thought he'd be praised in the gate, so to speak. I mean, people would compliment him because of this woman. All of that now was at stake. All of that now was in question. He trusted her. Yes, he believed her. Oh, but friend, this was quite a story. This was quite a hard pill to swallow. This was something kind of tough to take in. This was almost too sensational, unbelievable. But Joseph, even before God confirmed in his heart, listen, that Mary is virtuous, that she is pure, that she is chaste. Even before God confirmed that, Joseph, he decided he would react the right way. He'd do the right thing. Did you know it looked worse on him than her? Did you know it was more pressure on him than her? Did you know that in Jewish society of that day? Oh yes, Mary would be ostracized. She would be an outcast. She would be put aside. She would be thought dishonorable. Oh yes, Mary would have had all of this thoughts against her, but what it looked like Joseph just couldn't wait. It looked like Joseph was the one pushing, you know, to dishonor her. It looked like that Joseph was the one that was going against Jewish tradition. He was the one that was going against, listen, doing the right thing. It was more pressure on him than her. You might say, well, then it complimented him to take her aside and put her out of the way and put her in a place over here where she wouldn't be ridiculed. It would compliment him. It might to a little extent, but still people knew why he did it. And so there was more pressure on him, but he reacted the right way. There's a reason that his name is mentioned before Mary's in the Bible in this story. Friend, I'm telling you, God had a plan and God chose these two. And friend, you better believe. Hey, even in Luke and even in Matthew, what does it tell us about Joseph? The son of who? David. The son of David. It makes sure that you and I get that. He's the son of David. Listen, why was Mary chosen? One of the big reasons she was chosen is because she was a spouse to Joseph. Has to be. Read your genealogies. She was a spouse to Joseph. She couldn't have been a spouse to somebody of the tribe of Benjamin. She couldn't have been a spouse to somebody in the tribe of Levi or the tribe of Reuben or one of these other tribes. She couldn't have been espoused to them. She had to be espoused to Joseph, and Joseph himself was in direct line and lineage of David. And so that's one of the big reasons. But can I say to you today, look how he reacted. Look what he did. Why did he do it that way? It's because the Lord was in his heart. It's because he was sanctified. Listen, that was sanctified. As Samuel said, as God said to Samuel over there when he was choosing David as a king, when Eliab and all these men were walking by, they were all men of great stature and big, manly men, kingly looking men. You remember what the Lord said to Samuel? He said, look, he said, you're looking on the outward appearance. He said, I've rejected him. You're looking on the outward appearance. He said, man looks on the outward appearance. He said, God looks on the heart. There's your verse. Friend, listen, God looks on the heart today. And I'm telling you, friend, he will arrange it. He will make it possible where people around us will be able to see our real heart too. Yes, he will. They don't do that with the things we plan to do, with the things we practiced, with the things we plotted over, with the things we've rehearsed, with the things we strategized. And can I stress this morning, there's not a thing in the world wrong with a good plan. There's not anything wrong with educating yourself about something so you can make a better presentation. There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with having a good strategy. There's nothing wrong with that. But friend, you don't see everything about the person when something like that is put forth and presented. You didn't see that. Kevin back there won our chili hickey, our chili thing. He won that. And you know what? When you ate some of that, all of it was good. All of it was good. When you ate some of that, you'd have to agree. It was good. It was all good. Tough choice. But still, it was all good. But we didn't see when he burned his finger and stuck his finger in his mouth. We didn't see when he got aggravated out there trying to buy all his ingredients to finally get them together. We didn't see when he's hunting the right pot and maybe couldn't find it. All that kind of thing. Maybe none of that happened. But we didn't see what happened behind the scenes, did we? No, we didn't see that. Friend, I'm telling you, listen, we actually see the way a person really is when they have to react to something. Jesus said to the Pharisees in Matthew's Gospel chapter number 12, he gave about five verses right there. He talks about talking about the fruit of a tree. He says either let the tree be good, its fruit good, or let it be corrupt. In other words, it is either or. Let it be that way. He's directing this toward the Pharisees that were hypocrites. They looked real good in public. They liked to pray in front of people. They liked to do all these kind of things that would really make them seem like they were religious powerhouses, like they were Holy Ghost movers. But friend, I'm telling you, he said inside them, he said they're like what they're like is a polished grave. Everything's real nice out here, looks real good. But inside, there's a dead person. And he said, they're like that. And but what he told them in this particular passage, Nathan will scroll down for us there. What he told them, he said, from the abundance of their heart is what they talked about. In other words, Christ is saying our heart is a very abundant place. It can hold a lot of things. Our wills, our emotions, our ways. Listen, our values. All of these things are part of who we are. That's what's in our heart. And friend, listen, when you react to something, what you're going to react with is what you've got the most of, amen? If you've got more of God in your heart than you have the world, you'll react in a godly way. But if that world is still there, I'm telling you, you're going to react in a worldly way. I had a friend one time, he saved, and a fellow we worked with, he and I served as a pallbearer for our friend. Been a lot of years ago now, but this fellow kept working on him. Old boy was a pretty good old boy, but he cussed every breath. He liked to drink on the weekends or whenever he could and this kind of thing. And so my friend, he got to working on him, finally got him going to church with him. And there after a while, he was trying to break himself from cussing. And I told him, I said, buddy, I said, do you know for sure, for real, that you've been saved? You know that. I mean, I'm not talking about when somebody pushed his button and cussed. He was trying to break himself from cussing. And friend, it might have been that way for him. I don't want to sound real judgmental, but I want you to know this. The Bible tells if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. A new creation. A new creation. Not an old creation trying to do better. Not an old creation trying to act new. He said he's brand new. He's a new creation. I can tell you this. Listen, when I got my heart right with God, I didn't want no more marijuana. When I got my heart right with God, I didn't want to be opening more Playboy magazines. When I got my heart right with God, I had a desire to want to go to the house of God. I started enjoying the things of God. I started getting interested in the Word of God. I'm here to tell you, I'm not perfect, no, and won't be till I get there. But can I say today, he changed something in me. Hallelujah. Amen. Wasn't the same. Wasn't the same. Friend, I'm telling you, David, King David, you remember when Absalom pulled his coup attempt, you remember that? David had to leave. He could have stayed in Jerusalem and fought against Absalom and all the others that had joined him, but if he did, that meant his hand himself would have been directly involved in killing Absalom, his favorite son. David didn't want that. So what David done, he and his mighty men, they left Jerusalem. In other words, he's willing to let him come right on in there. But they left Jerusalem, and he gave instructions to the men who were fighting for him to keep Absalom safe, not to kill him. We know Joab ignored that. But on David's way out of Jerusalem, we see a man show up in the scriptures. His name is Shimei. You remember him? Shimei. And so he shows up in the scripture, and what he does is David and these mighty men, as they were going along, as they're leaving Jerusalem, he gets over here on the side of the road, and he throws rocks at him. He throws dust up in the air, and he shouts curses at him. And he tells him, he said, the Lord has returned this upon your head for the way that you've done the house of Saul. I mean, he's just taking advantage of his moment, and he's doing that. And so I think it's Abishai. He tells David, he said, let me go. He said, who is this dead dog that he cursed the king this way? He said, let me go over there and take his head off. He said, who is he to do this? And David said, oh, no. He said, no. He said, what have I to do with you, you sons of Jeriah? Jeriah was David's sister. These were his nephews. And so he said, what do I have to do with you? He said, no, I'm not going to do this. He said, the Lord has given him an opportunity. I'm paraphrasing a little, but what he's insinuating is this man has taken an opportunity. He's taken advantage of the situation and this condition, and the Lord is letting him do it. He said, Absalom wants to kill me. Said, how much more this Benjamite? David said, no, just let him curse.
Just let him curse and maybe the Lord will look favorably on me for my reaction. That word reaction's not in there. But that's what he's implying. He'll look favorably on me because I've reacted this way. Because I'm handling it this way. Because I'm doing it like this. He'll look favorably on me. Just let him curse. Let him go ahead. Just let him do it. We'll do it this way. And whenever David was restored to the throne, you remember Shimei came back. He came back then with his hat in his hand. And he came back and David told him, he said, as long as you'll behave yourself, he said, you won't die. But we know that didn't happen under Solomon. He got killed. But can I say today, listen, the way David reacted was what mattered at the time. Can I say to you today, listen, the way you and I react to the motivation or the leading of the calling or the bidding of the Lord really matters today. These people didn't argue with him. Mary asked him how all this would happen. She asked Gabriel that. She was within her rights to ask that. Listen, if the Lord puts something on your heart to do, if he puts something on your heart to, friend, to oversee or whatever it is, he's put it on your heart, then you've got every right to ask the Holy Spirit, well, how do I go about it? How's it going to be? How's it going to work? I don't have to know everything just as long as I know you're in charge, but I want to make sure this is you, Lord. I want to make sure that this is what you have me to do. I want to make sure it's right. So she was well within her rights to do that, but she didn't argue. She didn't talk it away. Gosh, the Lord can still use people that do that. Look at all the excuses Moses mounted at the burning bush. He stutters. He's not eloquent. All this kind of thing. I mean, all these excuses. God just kept shooting them down, didn't he? He said, well, we'll send Aaron with you. He can talk. All this kind of thing. Friend, how much better would it be? And I like what the scripture says there. The Lord said, we'll send Aaron. He can talk for you. But he said, am I not God? Did I not make your mouth? If Moses stuttered, you know what he had an opportunity to do right then? Father, I'll do it. I'm a little afraid of it. I know Pharaoh. I know the Egyptian culture. I'm a little bit afraid here, but you just bless me and help my fears, and you touch my mouth where I can talk good. Hallelujah. He got his stuttering healed right then. Absolutely. But he didn't do it, did he? Now, let's make this excuse. How many today is sitting right here in this building, maybe watching us online, how many today knows that you're going to lose reward in heaven just because you didn't believe God's power in what he has bid you and called you to do? Just because you wouldn't accept it. Just because you put it down. Friend, I'm here to tell you, listen, hey, it'd be awesome to hear, well done, my good and faithful servant. Been faithful over a few things, I'll make you rule over many. That'd be awesome to hear that. But friend, it's people like Mary and Joseph that'll hear that. Yes, people that reacts right, listen to the calling of God. And can I say today, you might wonder, well, how come I face all this adversity? How come I deal with all these things? How come I'm having to, you know, deal with so much disappointment and so much distraction or so much difficulty, anxiety, whatever it is? Friend, did you know, hey, there's nothing that gets at you that God has not allowed? Now, sometimes you and I throw that door open ourselves. Yes, we do. God would have not allowed it had we just not welcomed it. You might say, well, explain that one. Well, the way it is this. The Bible said, he that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. We know, friend, that Satan takes advantage of every opportunity that you and I will exercise in neglect. You and I will exercise in rebellion. We better understand. Listen, according to 2 Timothy, he'll take us captive because that's his will. That's what he wants to do. He'll get us into those positions. Friend, when we feel our faith is compromised, when we feel weak, he wants to keep us down there, keep us in that place. Sometimes we just throw those doors open through rebellion and neglect, friend, and not serving the Lord. Even though we're saved, we're not doing it, and we should expect the enemy's worst, friend. Why? Because we've made that choice. Is that God's will? No. But I'm here to tell you, God will allow Listen, he will allow Satan in there to bring about chastening in our life, to turn our life around. Moses said to the children of Israel in the book of Numbers, he said, beware, your sins will find you out. Things we think is hid. Things we think nobody knows. Things we think nobody, you know, sees. Nobody cares about. There's a devil that cares about them. And he'll definitely wreck your life with them if he can. You better believe he'll bring them out into the open. He'll put you on that reactionary hot plate. People can see how you and me react, amen. They'll see how you and me, listen, deal with these things, how you and me adjust to these things. Friend, I'm telling you, but there's a lot of times that just plain old difficulty, anxiety, hard things. Friends, listen, a lot of times that those kind of conditions will come into our life. God's allowed them in our life. God knows our heart. How many knows he knows our heart better than we know our heart? But how many knows you and I need to know our heart? We need to know this, don't we? That's why he tells us to pray. That's why he tells us to supplicate. That's why he tells us to talk to him about these things. God knows what we need according to the scripture before we ask him. He knows what we need before we ask him. But he still tells us to ask him. My goodness, I'm telling you, I don't know about you, what God does automatically. Listen, I praise him for that, but I just kind of like this. Thank you, Lord, for all the things that you do for me, because he does a whole lot of things that I don't even know about, don't consider. He does. But those things I've asked him to do, and he hears and answers those prayers. I'm telling you, I can shout all over the house for those things, hallelujah, because I was involved in them. I was part of it. Listen, he did something for me. He did something for you when he's answered those prayers that you've called upon him and asked him about. Friend, I'm telling you, you can be blessed when you hear about those things being better, those people being well, those things coming together, those things being provided, those people being saved. Yes, you can rejoice in that. But he'll allow these troubles and trials to come into our life. He'll allow you to get cut off in traffic sometime just to see how you react. I thought you said he knew how we'd react. He does. But you don't always, do you? I don't always, do I? No. David, this same David I was talking about that spared Shimei after he sinned with Bathsheba, after Nathan came to tell him, you know, give him that story. You remember how he gave him that story about the poor man's lamb that was taken? David got mad. He wasn't no mercy that day. He said, he shall surely die. And he'll restore fourfold everything he's took. Nathan said, good, thou art the man. Thou art the man. What was the difference? David wasn't right with God. David wasn't in the will of God. David was fostering and hiding a sin. He wasn't there. But it was this same David that wrote in Psalms 139, I believe it's 139, Nathan's got it, I gave it to him. But it's this same David that wrote, he wrote, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. Notice the next verse. And see. In other words, does God need to see? No. David needed to see. And see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Friend, can I say today, if you're sitting here this morning, you're watching me today, and you know if certain buttons were pushed, then it would be just like you were a lost person, at least for a few minutes. That's something you need to work on. That's something you and I need to confess to God. That's something we need to get right in our heart, because I'm telling you, listen, there's nobody, everybody that was able to walk into this building today, you're going to have some reactions before dark. You'll have some reactions after dark. You don't know what's coming. You can't see the future. You and I are constantly reacting to things. Constantly. So how do we do that? Do we do that in grace? Do we do that, listen, in a strength, in a settled fashion? Do we do that? Fella hit me in my old green truck one time. Man, he got out of his car all mad. Said that the blinker wasn't working on that truck. And I said, I had it on. He said, well, yes, but said, this is my only car. And said, you caused me to hit you, and you didn't have your blinker on.
Well, I said, well, I had it on, but I don't know if it was working or not. This is a 20-year-old truck, so I really don't know. But I had it on. Oh, man, he's mad. And I told him, big guy, too. And I told him, I said, look, buddy, I said, I'm sorry about your car. But I said, you hit me. He said, you're right. You're right. I said, well, I said, I'm sorry. I'm sorry about your car. But I said, you hit me. And so when the state patrol come, he told him, he said, you was running about 10 miles an hour over the speed limit, weren't you? He said, oh, no, no, no. He said, look, I can measure these black marks you left. Said, you left 50 feet of black mark. Said, we determined you're going this fast when you do that. He come over to me and he said, he tells me your blinker wasn't working. I said, well, he may be right. Again, it's a 20-year-old truck. He may be right. But I said, I did have it on. He said, well, let's go check it out. So I just opened the door and I reached in there, didn't touch anything. He's right behind me. I just turned the switch on, that old blinker started working. Tail light back there, the blinker was working. He said, seen enough. I wasn't trying to get that fella in no trouble. I'm just simply saying, look, he and I could have maybe come to blows or had us a big fuss or whatever, but there wasn't any use in that, amen? No use in that. And by the way, I've got this position to think about. I got this position to think about. But not only do I have this position to think about, Brother Donald, you got one to think about. Joe, you even got one to think about. You're sitting here on this front bench. People online see you, buddy. You do, Wade. You do, Doug. You got one. Our deacons, Josh, you got a position to think about. Yes, you do. Several, actually. But still, you do. You got a position to think about. Every one of you do. David, Raymond, Sandra, all of you. Listen, all our musicians up here, Michael and the others, Brother Wayne when he played. We got a position to think about. Yes, we do. Friend, I'm telling you, listen. How do we react to things? Because you're going to start through this season. If you hadn't already, you're going to be interacting with your family. And did you know nobody pushes your buttons like them? Maybe my family's the only one like that. I don't know. But usually nobody pushes your buttons like your folks do. Nobody does. Thomas just thinks he can get Tracy mad. He ain't got nothing on me, amen. Just thinks he can. No, 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 nobody. Listen, nobody does that like you folks do. Mm-mm. So we're going to have an opportunity for people to really see our real heart. Mary and Joseph was chosen, listen, because God knew how they would react. He knew that. The next time you find yourself in a difficult situation, you may be in one right now. You may be dealing with something right now that you don't know how in the world you're going to ever get it resolved. You don't know how it's going to come out, turn out. You just don't know. But you've placed your faith in the Lord. You've laid it all in His hands. You've put it there on His altar of ability because you know He can handle it and He can do it. You might say, what should be my prayer today? This should be your prayer. Lord, help me to react right. Lord, help me to understand it. Help me to be what you'd have me to be when it all comes together. Help me to do that, Lord. You remember what he said? He said, if somebody bids you to go a mile, go what? Two. That's what he said, go two. Somebody wants your coat, wants your cloak. He said, just give it to them. Just hand it to them. Give it to them. Said, if they sue you to take it away from you, just let you have. You might say, well, what's he telling us? Just to be so passive that it don't matter? No, no, no. He's talking about the conditions of our heart. He's talking about what we put, listen, in a place of high value. He's not talking about our pride. I'll tell you, let me include this while Miss Sandra comes, Brother Donald comes. Let me include this real quickly today. Listen, we talk about difficult times, hard times, those kind of things. A lot of times we just naturally turn to the Lord in a time like that. That should be our first reaction. But can I say, listen, materialism, prosperity, there's nothing that will ruin, listen, that will ruin the opportunities of faith for you than feeling like you don't need God for nothing else. Do you remember the Laodicean church in Revelation chapter 3? You remember them? What was their problem, by the way? Their problem was that they were rich and had need of nothing. We don't need nothing. No, don't need nothing. We got all we need. They were rich
How many knows the Lord won't tolerate idols? If you and I really belong to him today, you know one of the worst things I could do is start worshiping my house? My house liable to burn down if I put it between him and between the Lord and me. You might say, oh, God wouldn't do that. I didn't say he would. But I can tell you there's an enemy that's just itching to get at me, to bring me back in line, amen? Just itching to do those things. Friend, hey, anything that I have that I start putting before God, in the spirit, I need to start expecting him to deal with that and do something about that. He'll remove stumbling blocks. He'll take these things out of the way. Friend, I'm telling you, listen, if we put him first, then these other things are blessed. When these other things are, listen, these other things are put first, then hey, we offer and we invite a curse into our life. If you don't believe me, read your scripture. Read Hebrews chapter number 12. The Bible tells us, if you read about King Saul, you remember King Saul? You remember how Saul got all prideful? You remember how Saul got to wanting to please the people instead of pleasing God? You remember that? How he did all that? You know what the Bible said? The Bible said that these spirits, listen, God was talking to these spirits, and one of them said, I will go and be a lying spirit in the mouth of his prophets. Does God sanction lies? No. But listen, there was a demonic spirit just itching to cause him trouble, just itching to be a part, listen, of this person's being chastened. He was just itching for that. Friend, I'm telling you, what's keeping that devil off of us? The hand of the Holy Spirit. That's what it is. It's not me. It's not you. But listen, the message is today showing the real us, the real you, the real you. You're going to have an opportunity to do that, listen, even probably even before you get out of this building. Somebody steps you on your foot, you'll have an opportunity to show the real you. Somebody opens their door on your car, you'll have an opportunity to show the real you. Somebody offers you a little criticism, what they think you ought to be doing or the way you should change or what you should not be doing, you'll have an opportunity to show the real you. Friend, I'm telling you, we constantly do it. It's our reactions that shows people what's really in our heart and who we really are. You might say, what should I do? We should get up in the morning and say, Lord, help me to be a blessing today. Lord, you know what I'm going to face today. Lord, you know the things I'll deal with today. You know what the devil's plans are today. But Father, greater and more important than that, what's your plans today? What do you want done? What are we going to do today? Miss Thina Tilson used to start her prayers, Lord, what are you up to today? And so, yes, friend, how are we going to be reacting to these things that is not going to be so pleasant? How are we going to be reacting to these people that we know that there's some people you know in your mind, those people just rub you the wrong way. And so, friend, listen, you know you're going to be in contact with that person that day. You've heard me say it before. You ought to ask the Lord, Lord, you know I'll be dealing with them today. You know I'm going to be around them today. Father, I want to show your glory. Lord, I want to show the works and the likeness of Christ. I want to be what you'd have me to be. I heard a story one time, tell you this real quickly. This daughter had came to complain to her dad, and her dad ran a restaurant. He was a chef there, a real successful place. And he had given her a whole lot of stuff and done a lot for her. And here she was, she showed up, and she was complaining, and she was griping about certain things, not being just right, not going her way. She's a pretty spoiled little old girl, but anyway, she was talking about that. He said, come in here in the kitchen with me a few minutes. And he took him three boilers, put water in them, and he put three boilers on the stove. And so he turned them up. He turned the heat up, and they started boiling. And one of them, he dropped a potato, and one of them, he dropped an egg, and the other one, he took a cup of coffee and he poured in the other one. And so as they were boiling, after a few minutes, ever how long it was, and this girl was standing there, you know, looking at that and trying to figure out what in the world kind of a illustration he's doing. After a few minutes, he turned them all off. And so he reached in there with his tongs and he got out the egg and he put it on a saucer here. He got out the potato and he put it on a saucer here. And he took a cup and he poured some of the coffee out of the pot into the cup. And he set them all three down and he asked her, he said, well, what do you see right there? She said, an egg, a potato, and a cup of coffee. He said, what can we deduce from this? She said, I don't know. I have no idea what you're doing. She said, well, he said, well, this potato. He said, how was this potato before I put it into the boiling water? He took a fork and he just pressed that potato and it just went right through the middle of the potato. And she said, well, it was hard. He said, well, what's happened to it? She said, well, it's softer. And he got the egg and he took his tongue and he got the egg and he squeezed on the egg. And he said, what's happened to this egg? And she said, well, it was soft, it's got harder. He said, right, right, so far you're right. And then he just handed her the cup of coffee and he said, well, what about the cup of coffee? And she said, I said, it just dissolved in the water. And she said, so. He said, so all three of these things, they were facing the same conditions. For the potato, it was hard and it made it softer. For the egg, it was soft and it made it harder. But he said, for the coffee, it took the water that it was boiling in and changed it to something altogether different. And his illustration, the moral of his story was, that's what you can do when you react the right way. You can take those circumstances, those things, because God is God. He never leaves you. He never forsakes you. Well, you and I can take those circumstances and they can be something. Listen, they, even though it was the hot water we were into, God can bless that and God can make that something that is appreciated and something that is useful, something that it is even good. You remember what he said in Romans 8 and 28? Hey, we'll take those things, listen, those things that the enemy meant for evil and make them for good. That's what Joseph said. Romans 8 and 28 tells us that all things work together for the good. Listen, for those, he said, that are called according to his purpose, how we'll react, how are we going to react to whatever it is that we're confronted with today? And especially what the Lord has put on your heart to do. Will you just say yes to him? Will you just say, Lord, I accept that? You and I can do anything, Father. In you, we can do anything. You might say, well, I don't know. I would have accepted it a long time ago, but it seemed too hard. Would it be harder than what Mary was asked to do? Would it be harder than what Joseph was facing? Would it be harder than that? Would it be harder than what Jesus faced in the garden when he said, not my will, but thine be done? Be harder than that? Surely not. As we stand together today, are you ready for the challenges? Are you ready to deal with whatever might come your way? I hope you are. Story just this past week about a young man in the Navy, and he came home and he'd met this young lady and they'd gotten married. She was from Tennessee. He'd been in school up there in some training, and they'd gotten married actually right up here at Crescent Hill, a beautiful little church in the valley. And so They were going back to California. He was stationed there. Everything was going great. Somewhere out in New Mexico, she decided she wanted a pillow out of the back seat of the car. She reached back there, she unbuckled her belt, reached back there to get a pillow to kind of make herself a little more comfortable. For some reason, he had reached over to kind of try to help her. The next thing he knew, the tires on the left had caught the curb of the road, sent him across the road, threw him out of the car, killed her. His parents was coming home from Wednesday night prayer service, and they got a call from the authorities in New Mexico. They told them, they said, this license plate, the young man's, his credentials, all these kind of things. He said, that's why we called you, connected him with you. And said, it's right now, said, we can't tell you if either one of them's made it or not. They didn't know. And just in that quick of an instance, that joyful time of that family, you say, well, that don't always happen, and thank God it don't. But it can. And in that few minutes, it completely and forever changed their lives. Can I say today, are we absolutely ready? You remember the old story about Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde? Dr. Jekyll was kind, caring, compassionate, wasn't he? But Mr. Hyde was a monster. Friend, I'm telling you, you might say, well, I've seen people shout, and I've seen people praise, and all these kind of things. I've seen people preach. I've seen people sing, all this kind of thing. Friend, I'm telling you, I'm thankful they were doing those things, but can I say, it's how they react out there in their life. It's the things they do out there in their lives. Adrian Rogers said, not how high you jump on Sunday, how straight you walk on Monday, that matters. And so today, listen. It's time you and I, as a modern day church, listen, cling to being a genuine, born again child of God and act that way, be that way, regardless of where we are, in here or out there. I'm not saying you don't. I'm just praising you if you do. But listen, it's time that we did that. And so, friend, if you say, well, I haven't been reacting too good to certain conditions, then that tells you where you ought to start praying right there. That tells you what needs to be addressed in your life right there. That lets you know where your weaknesses are right there. So this morning, thank you for being here. And do be praying for our cast tonight that they'll be blessed and things will improve, and those improvisions that they have to make, that they'll be able to do that. All that'll go good, because I say they've been working on it a while, and I know they want to be a blessing. And so you just pray that they can be. Come back tonight. See that if you can. 6 o'clock. I guess we have, do we have fruit bags this year for the kids? We normally do. So we've got that. And so everything, I think, is ready. So please come back and be a part of that. Next Sunday, let me go ahead and say this. Christmas Eve would be a great time to have a service. We've not had one on Christmas Eve. There have been very few Sundays in the past that Christmas Eve was on Sundays. We've had several Christmases on Sunday, but very few times has Christmas Eve been on Sunday. But I've been talking to a number of our folks, just kind of get a feel for what you're doing, and it seems everybody has got family things that you're doing on Christmas Eve, so we won't be having a service on Christmas Eve, but we will have a service next Sunday morning. And for New Year's, if any of you's planning to party, you ain't gonna be doing it at 7 o'clock, are you? So if you want to, we'll just come on and study the Bible on the next Sunday. That'll be New Year's Eve, and you're usually out of here by 7 o'clock. And so if that sounds good, we'll just do that on New Year's, and we'll just go ahead with that. So yeah. That's what I say. Not that night.
Oh, not that.
Yeah. Was I confused? I'm sorry.
Yeah. The way you made it sound, we're not having service at all. Then you said we'll have a Sunday service Sunday morning. Or Sunday.
Oh, I'm sorry. Well, what I meant, Christmas Eve would be a good time to have a service that night. A lot of churches do, but we won't, because we've got a lot of
folks doing family things. So not that night. I'm sorry. Whew, see now, you got to react right. You see what I'm saying? I could have got mad at this bunch over here and said, y'all didn't even listen to me. You know what I'm saying? But I didn't. Didn't do that. So hallelujah. Yes. Anything else to be said about before we go? Clearing that up, guys. Thank you, Miss Sherry. And we certainly appreciate Miss Sandra, Sherry, and others that helped to get some baskets around to our shut-in folks and our folks that hadn't been able to come for a while, and even some of our senior folks that have been able to be here. We appreciate that, guys. Appreciate you showing that caring to them. Anything else this morning? If not, I want to ask Brother David Tanksley if he'll dismiss us today. Brother David, if you'll do that.